Hello and welcome to this installment of our RSAC 365 webcast series. Our topic today is Sherlock Holmes, finding threats we didn't know we were looking for. I'm your host, Casey Zirkus, content strategist for the RSA conference team. During the webcast, all participants will be in listen-only mode. Our guest, Kara Nance, will be taking questions at the end of the session. So if you have a question for her, please submit it through the Q&A feature. As a reminder, this webcast is being recorded. Following the webcast, you'll receive an email containing the link to the video replay. The replay will also be posted at rsaconference.com. And I'm also pleased to let you know that as part of our RSAC 365 cybersecurity learning program, we accept submissions on any topic year round. You can contribute your expertise on a webcast, podcast, seminar, or blog by visiting rsaconference.com/become-a-contributor. I'd now like to invite our guest, Kara Nance, to introduce herself so that she can get started.
Thank you, Casey. I'm Kara Nance. I've worked with a lot of businesses and nonprofits over time. I'm currently the Chief Technology Officer at cyberratings.org, which is a nonprofit testing organization that provides unbiased testing of cybersecurity products and services. And it's an awesome fit for me because I love solving these sorts of puzzles. I'm the co-author of the Ghidra book, The Definitive Guide, and I conduct a lot of training in the evolution of this reverse engineering tool since it was originally released. I've had a long history with a lot of different roles. I was a computer science professor for many years before transitioning to government and industry. So that being said, you'll see that this talk includes a lot of cybersecurity concepts, but also some things outside of cybersecurity that are more big picture that I think we could do well to include as we develop cybersecurity products. So what are we going to go over today? Why I'm in cybersecurity, what I learned in school, the approaches we use to solving problems, both with using our own brains and using computers, how we can apply this to cybersecurity, and then how we can do this thing to identify threats. And the final challenge problem is, what is that thing in the corner? And we'll discover that as we move through this talk. So, why am I in cybersecurity? How did I get here? Even as a really young child, before I went to school, I think I always drove my parents a little bit crazy. I always wanted to understand everything. I asked why constantly. I came from a large family, so with six kids, my parents were very busy. So an answer I frequently heard was, you know, why? The answer was because. So I learned at a very, very young age before school to find answers for myself. I was a voracious reader. I read everything I could get my hands on, and I investigated things. My father had a garage full of tools and machines, and he taught me to use them. So I have all these memories of like proudly installing electrical sockets in my bedroom when my dad took on the task of building a house. He let me put seven in my small bedroom, knowing I would be likely to use them all, and I did. But I, even more than building things, I like to take things apart. I like to figure out how they work and how the parts work together. And then I'd use this knowledge to invent new things or new uses for old things. So sometimes all the parts made it back into the object. Sometimes they didn't. But I love doing this kind of thing. Let me figure out what things can do. And sometimes things that, you know, that things could do that maybe they weren't supposed to do or weren't designed to do. But this was all, you know, discovery-based learning where I just was free to do whatever I wished. It was a build versus break mentality, and it led me to reverse engineering. So what can we reverse engineer? Well, everybody, if you ask why a lot, you're probably a natural reverse engineer. And you may apply that to different fields. So problem solvers, we do this all the time. Doctors reverse engineer people, mechanics reverse engineer cars, help desk reverse engineer computers. As a malware analyst, we reverse engineer malware, but we learn things about things by taking them apart, looking at them, and then figuring out why they do what they do, how they do what they do, and what else we can make them do. Okay, so then what did I learn in school? Well, I went to school and we had science classes and science labs, and we learned, you know, the scientific process, which was kind of the opposite of what I had done before. So we start with a hypothesis and design an experiment and collect and analyze data and come up with conclusions. But it was kind of, you know, you had to have this vision and this thinking ahead kind of process, which wasn't my usual approach. So at the same time, in English classes, I'm learning about, you know, Sir Arthur Conan Doyle and Sherlock Holmes, and on TV, I'm watching Star Trek and, you know, other cool things. And Spock is fascinating to me because he's so logical. So I kind of had this conflict going between these two approaches to solving problems. And I realized that I didn't have to make a decision, that I could use both of these approaches for various problems. And as a result, sometimes come up with very, very unique solutions to problems. So I love to share this image. As we evolve technologies, we have two approaches. We have this incremental approach where we keep, you know, making things a little bit better and changing things a little bit better to adapt to new situations and going on and on like that. And then there are times and just somebody does something totally different. They look at the environment and they're like, here's a new idea, a new approach, a new way to do things. So this image is actually based on an experience I had where I kind of went, wow, you know, maybe we should be approaching things a little bit differently. So when iPads first came out, being an active member of a techno nerd family, of course, my daughter had one of the first iPads, and she was 4 at the time, and iPad had with it a drawing program. And drawing programs were interesting because they kind of, as having been a computer science professor over time, I had seen this evolution from, you know, chalkboards, and then we had colored chalk, which is, if you looked really closely, were different colors. And then we moved to whiteboards, and we're like, awesome, you know, and all of a sudden we have these markers in different colors, and we can erase without getting stuff all over us. And it was, you know, amazing. Well, these sorts of, this evolution continued onto an iPad and the draw apps. And draw apps were available because that's what people want to do. So the draw apps, which still looked very similar, had generally a little, you know, an area where you could actually draw and write and do things. And then over on the right was the equivalent of our markers. And an eraser, but instead of using, you know, picking these things up, now we're on an iPad, so we're going to, like, touch the marker colors to, quote, pick up a marker, and we're going to, you know, touch the eraser to pick up the eraser, and because the majority of the world was right-handed, all of these things appeared on the right side, and on the left, we saw a nice little, you know, area that served as our whiteboard. So I played with this, and I wrote some things, and I thought, cool, this is really awesome. Then I handed the iPad to my 4-year-old, and she had not experienced chalkboards, and she had not experienced whiteboards. So she jumped on this thing and she looked at it and she experimented a little and she realized it had been designed entirely wrong. So she spun the iPad, which was on the floor, spun it around the opposite direction because she saw no reason why she shouldn't be able to change colors with one hand as she was drawing with the other. And as a result, this image that you see was impossible. It crashed the program because no one thought of that approach. We had evolved over years this whiteboard etiquette that involved, you know, picking up a pen and drawing it, then setting that one down and picking up a different one and drawing with it. It didn't dawn on us that this capability, you know, of doing multiple things at once and changing as you're moving were reality and were how new users who hadn't been exposed to the legacy, I'll call them technologies, they really aren't, but the legacy situations, how they would use these technologies if it's the first technology they encountered or the first thing they encountered. So I see that all the time. I see it in my role as testing, which my specialization is focusing on the cloud, but I see a lot of, you know, as things get moved to the cloud, that it's not always approached as, this is a new environment and a new thing. So, you know, should I migrate what I have to this environment or should I design something new? So we've got people doing incremental approaches and monumental approaches, just fundamentally changing the game. And both of these are so important, but I do see issues associated with the incremental approach because we have now a fundamentally different platform. The rules are out the window with respect to some things that were bound by previously. So for example, with a firewall, okay, there are things people could do on a firewall only with physical access with a physical device. But in the cloud, that restriction isn't really there. We have an artificial boundary around a device, but it's just not the same. So the security threats are very different. The approaches to solving problems can be very different. So we need to look at this, particularly as we migrate things to the cloud, which is why I love this, the opportunity to do this unbiased testing and just see what is going on in these things, how well they're doing, how well they're protecting. It's just, I mean, it's like the perfect fit for me personally. So I want to jump back a little bit and talk about humans versus computers. Because another thing that I've seen over time is obviously, as all of us are seeing, is the evolution of technology. And as technologies evolve, there's a tendency to, you know, it's not really incremental because they are making new changes, but there's a tend to copy things we already know. For example, there's a lot of, you know, robotic development that walks on two legs. In reality, walking on two legs isn't a particularly stable environment, as anyone who's, as all of us know. And likewise, there are things that are challenging for computers that humans are good at and things that, you know, humans can do that are challenging to replicate within a computer. Okay, so what are some things we're really bad at? We are not particularly gifted at anything that involves redundancy. Same thing over and over again. We fatigue, we make mistakes, we miss things. I'm sure pretty much everyone can identify with some point in their life where they, you know, are looking for their keys in their house or looking for something. And, you know, you just can't find them. You can't remember where they are. And then you find them in a place you've already looked and you just missed it. Or say searching a list back in the good old days when we had phone books, you know, perusing, looking through these lists was a complicated process. Now it's just a word to find, you know, within a search. But those sorts of things humans are just not inherently good at. And consistency. I will go out and say that we are not particularly awesome at consistency. However, we do, we could probably beat computers in a running race. simple computers. Regardless of our emotions, like my computer makes me happy sometimes, it makes me sad, my computer's opinion of me probably never changes. So there are things that we, better variations that can be used for good or for evil with respect to humans and computers. Okay, so one thing we happen to be good at is analysis. So why are we actually good at analysis? Well, it's basically because of our brains, okay? The human brain is an incredible instrument and one we do not completely understand, okay? So let's look at this image, for example. So Rishika Kartik created this image. I have no idea what her artistic process is. I don't know if she had the final image in mind when she made it or if it evolved into what we see. It's kind of like a lot of the code bases I've seen over the years. But she has all these gifts and is always thinking of brand new, unique approaches to issues. Okay, so for instance, she spent a significant amount of time helping the blind create art and teaching the blind how to produce art. So she's got this passion and she's sharing it with a group of people who share the same passion and haven't always been provided an outlet for this creativity. So she has she's not doing things incrementally. She has made a monumental change and a different approach to something. And I think that's amazing. By the way, she is 16. So, let's see, go on to next. So let's talk about using our brain. And I'm going to run you through some quick exercises just to show you how awesome your brains are. And then we will I welcome questions. And you can actually type things in the chat on some of these because I'm used to discussing this with a live audience with some interaction. So I'm going to give you some challenges, and they're not overwhelming challenges. They're actually challenges people tend to do without being threatened. So let's go with this. Let's start with finding the difference between two images. So you're welcome to write in the chat if you happen to, you know, possess this advanced skill and can see what are some differences between two images. All right, I'm going to jump ahead and start telling you some of them. So frequently people will focus on the wall on the left, and they will say things like, well, the left one has one picture on the wall and the right one has two. Or someone might say, oh, here come in the, yeah. Someone might say, there's one mirror on the wall. There's two on the other one. There's one window. There's two windows in the other one. They'll say all these kinds of things. And I've yet to have an audience get into, you know, a fight over whether the things on the wall are pictures or windows or mirrors, because that isn't really the objective. The objective is to identify differences. And people will make these tacit agreements that, you know, it doesn't matter if it's a picture or a mirror or a television or whatever, it is a difference. And that is what we're trying to identify. Okay, so people do this. I'm seeing lots of things. We've got stuff under the bed, shoes, dots on ceilings, towels on the wall. I get that. A lot of times in Hawaii, they call it other things. It's very regional, the words that I get. But the shoes / slippers / stuff by the bed for the noncommittal, that's actually the image I showed you on slide one. Okay, when I said, what is this thing in the corner? And I'd be very surprised if anyone had identified that when you first saw the picture as shoes. They would say, that is like an ellipse with another ellipse around it, and next to it's another ellipse with another ellipse around it. But nowhere would people on the first slide say, hey, those are obviously shoes. Because we have this exciting ability to put seeing something in context can shape how we interpret that thing. So that's phenomenal. Okay, so now let's go on and talk about some other issues associated with this. So if I told you there are 6 differences between these 2 images, and really there were 8, what would happen? So most of you would probably stop at 6 and say, done, victory. If on the other hand, I told you there were 8 differences, and in fact, there were only 6, then I would probably be in a little bit of trouble because you would keep looking. You would not feel the sense of accomplishment, I'm done. So we have, we are great at algorithms. We are great at solving problems when we know the goal so that we know when we are done. Okay, so let's talk a bit about if I were to write a computer science, a program to actually solve this problem. So because the artwork is so, imprecise, it would be a challenging issue. So I could just take a pure algorithmic approach and just look at the pixels and say, if it's, you know, white in one image and black in another image, then that's a difference. But that just gives me a big giant list of pixels. So I can put in some creative, you know, edge detection things that could build little pictures out of it, but I still wouldn't get this additional context and meaning that all of you have put in the comments that put words behind the images that help people understand what you think this image means. Okay, so that is a really cool gift that we have that is hard to replicate in computers. Now let's take this image and let's redecorate and let's put, you know, paisley wallpaper and bright colors on the quilt and all of this. Once we do that, the computer program gets way more complicated. However, as humans, it suddenly gets easier. Adding this additional visual stimulation makes the problem easier for us, but more complex for the programmer. Okay, so let's go and look at a couple more. A lot of people do these as young children. They frequently get assigned in school where you need to find, you know, a list of words within this jumble of words. And sometimes we find things that aren't in the list, and sometimes there's things in the list that aren't in the puzzle. I ask people if they use an algorithmic approach to this. And, you know, brave people frequently, yes, absolutely, I do. And then we start talking about what's your algorithm. And we quickly determine that very few people use a consistent algorithmic approach to a problem like this. They will, if you look at what their actual process is, it usually starts with something like, well, I stare at it till something jumps out at me. And very frequently, because we tend to read top to bottom, left to right, Iron Horse is the first thing that jumps out at a lot of people. Having taught algorithm analysis and complexity many, many times, I can share that this is not a mathematically optimal approach. Okay, but that's the approach people use, and they get very good results. They glance around, they look at different angles, and eventually at the end, they may transition to an algorithmic approach where, you know, you didn't find a word that starts with B's, so you look for all the B's, and then you look around it and see if that will work. If I was programming a computer, I wouldn't do that top to bottom because it wouldn't be as efficient. The letters in the center are more likely to be used than the letters around the edge, so I'd start in the middle, you know, so I could write an algorithm to solve this. But as humans, we're not going to use an algorithmic approach that we can easily define, and we're also very likely to switch algorithms when we reach some threshold of frustration that causes us to switch between approaches to the problem. Okay, so here's another one. Take a second to read it. So anyone that was unable to read it or that it caused significant issues for is probably no longer online. So those of you that remain probably didn't have a problem with this. Your brains are awesome. You're decoding this as you go along, and as you read, you're getting faster and faster at the pace with which you're reading. Okay? You are mapping, you know, what you see to what you know. And this is incredible because, let's say, so embedded in this are kind of the rules for writing this. But I violated the rule in the second word. And I'm doubting anyone hit the second word and said, obviously this won't work. However, had I programmed a computer giving and provided it with the information, you know, that I said, first and last letters, the rest rearranged, it would have been unable to continue after the second word. Okay, so this is a very, very interesting puzzle. We can just decrypt it and get faster and faster, whereas writing the code to do this is really complex, because we'd have to try all the permutations. You know, even if you could improve it. Yes, Cambridge really did write this, for the person who's asking it. This research has been published. So we could write this code. We'd have to, like, come up with lots of permutations. We would have to look up those words in dictionaries. Then we'd have to put them into context. And it's really challenging to get a computer, write a program that can do this in one pass. But yet all of you could. So that's pretty amazing, something we can do. If you, like, dinner tonight, you want some good conversation over dinner, ask a group if they can tell a cat from a dog, and they'll say yes. But then try to narrow it down to how much of a cat they need to see to definitively identify it as a cat. And it's amazing, because you'll realize that you don't know. And, you know, they'll say, like, you know, I need to see its eyes, because the eyes are different in a cat than a dog. But, you know, I can recognize a cat from the back. So you just, these discussions can get really, really deep, and we just don't know all of the answers. Okay. And then if you want it to, the conversation continue past dinner to dessert, then start adding, like, cartoon cats like Garfield, et cetera, or Odie, who looks nothing like a dog, but has been fully accepted, you know, as a dog in our world. So what are some things we are, as humans, are really good at? We are really good at pattern recognition, and we're also really good at dealing with missing information, uncertainty, and adapting, okay? So on the right is the picture that most of you identified as shoes or slippers by the bed, but looking at it here, I don't think anyone would identify it as that. And on the left, you know, I show this picture and it's like, oh, it's rainbow, you know, it's something, la la la. But if I put it in a context, so here, and I will tell you, it is the part of the logo for the digital forensics research group, you would say, oh, okay, it's probably a fingerprint. Okay, so we are really good at understanding context and also identifying and finding these contexts. So it's unfair to computers to talk about what we're good at without also taking a jump as to what we're not quite so good at. So there are some problems associated with the way our brain works. So I'm going to ask you to turn off your computer, not your physical computer, your brain and your head. If you turn off your computer, you won't see this. So on the next page, I'm going to show you an image. And I want you to look at the image and appreciate it for the work of art it is, but don't alter it in your mind in any way. Just look at it and appreciate it. Okay, I can tell you that already everyone has failed. Okay, we can't help it. We've got some missing data here, and so we mentally fill this in. Okay, there's a group, I'm predictively going to say, there's a group that are going to come up with math. There's a group that are going to come up with moth. Those are my biology people. There's that group sitting in the back that said meth, hopefully just Breaking Bad fans, and then my gamer group, yay, that came up with myths. So these types of puzzles are fun. We love them. How many of you applied, you think, a conscious algorithm to solving this? Probably not a ton. So, and because I removed a vowel, actually I didn't remove it, I wrote it without it. Some of you would say, well, it's got to be one of these. You would narrow down your process. But if had I removed a consonant, then it's a little bit different problem and you might use a more algorithmic approach. But most of you would start with some kind of pattern matching, matching words you know. A computer, it'd be much harder to, you know, to program a computer to do this when you consider the speed at which all of you just solved it. Okay, so let's look at another exercise. I'm gonna ask what's wrong with this picture. So people are happy to start immediately telling me what's wrong with this picture. And no two people will come up with the same things or the same approach. Okay, so what's happening here? Depending on where you are, I can somewhat predict some of the things I'm going to see. Since people tend to focus on the center of a picture, the first comment I get is, why does, you know, the monkey have a unicorn horn? Or why does a unicorn have a monkey face? Why does a deer have a turtle shell? Why does the turtle have antlers? And basically, I've done a couple of things. First, I biased you by telling you there was something wrong with the picture and tasking you with finding something about the picture. But here's reality. There's nothing wrong with this picture. You are likely experiencing discomfort because you're seeing images that don't match a pattern that are in your experiential database. Okay, so you're looking at this and you're mentally trying to fix things or resolve things, and you can't because you don't have something in your database that matches this pattern. Okay, so let's look at another one. Okay, I'm volunteer teaching AP statistics, so I love doing this with my class. Okay, correlation, causation. So people see, you know, patterns and they say, okay, yes, clear correlation between these two things, and now we'll investigate causation, etc. So let's look at the meaning behind these, though. Okay, so we have here on the left, the divorce rate in Maine correlated with the per capita consumption of margarine in the U.S. And on the bottom, we've got the per capita cheese consumption correlated with the number of people who died by becoming tangled in their bed sheets. So now that we've got a context, we're probably a little less likely to believe and attach, you know, yes, this is accurate, this is real. But I mean, the website's at the bottom there, and if you go there, you can just use valid data from two lists, and it will correlate for you by stretching, you know, axes, change, not modifying the data, but just changing the axes. And you can generate stuff like this. And it's very easy to manipulate what we're presenting to an audience. Okay, but we are so ingrained with the idea that what people see in an image, in a picture, in a graph, in anything, really is accurate and defines who they are. We actually made this a basis of psychology, right? Look at this image and tell me what you see. It was very common. And, you know, they would judge people based on what they saw in these Rorschach diagrams. And, you know, it's a psychological projective test to assess your personality. And so they would say things like, you know, the red represented blood. And so they say, oh, well, that means how they might respond to, you know, anger, physical harm. And some associated, you know, some psychologists would associate this blood with power, et cetera. But, you know, it's really dependent on what's happening in your brain. Because if I tell everyone in this, I'll tell all of you right now, what this actually is it's two gnomes high-fiving. Two garden gnomes saw each other, walked up, high-fived. Okay, so now it's going to be hard for you to unsee that and attach a different meaning to this image. Okay, so these kinds of things, we can change what people see based on suggestion. We can introduce bias, basically, by telling people what things represent. Okay, so what other things are we bad at that computers are good at? So computers don't fatigue. They are awesome at brute force algorithm. They can do the same thing over and over and over again. They can search and they can find things. They just don't miss things like we do. Like if I gave each of you a list of a million integers, eight-digit integers, and gave you a particular objective of what to find, a lot of you would miss it. Whereas a computer wouldn't, because they are the first one they look at, they're just as good when they're looking at the million or, you know, the 500th, they're just as good. They're great at doing the same thing over and over and over again. And we just are not. We fatigue. Okay, so let's see, what does this mean for cybersecurity? All right, coming back to cybersecurity. I talked about monumental versus incremental change, new ways and old ways. So let's just talk about some approaches to some common problems that we have and try and use that information within cybersecurity. Okay. So first I'm going to introduce the idea of visualization, because that is something we're great at, right? Pattern recognition, looking at pictures. So visualization just gives you a way to take a boatload of data and present it in a single digestible format. And this is awesome for cybersecurity because we generate a plethora of data. We've got logs and we've got this and we've got that. And data is one thing, but data can be organized to turn into information. Okay, so we can use visualization to display information, and that's what we do frequently, and I'm going to come back to this in a minute. So cybersecurity certainly could use more informational insight. Okay, so let's look at this. Okay, so we can, as cybersecurity professionals, approach this as a using the scientific method. Okay, we can go through and make tables and graphs and, you know, present our findings to people. But I'm more interested in when we don't know what we're looking for. When we've got this plethora of data and we have no idea what is possible. In that case, I like to go back and look more like a Sherlock Holmes approach. And what that involves is using abductive reasoning. And it's kind of not the way we tend to traditionally operate in the cybersecurity realm. And abductive reasoning begins with an incomplete set of observations, and then you use that to try and figure out, you know, what happened, the likeliest explanation for what we see. So how can visualization help with this? Well, as we said, we can use visualization to turn data into information, but we can also use visualization to find information in data. So I'm going to run through a couple of cybersecurity examples of this. So how can we use this? Okay, so this is a real set of data related to cybersecurity. It was provided by friends in the HoneyNet project, yay, and we published some things. based on this. So basically, if I give this picture to anyone, and it doesn't have to be a highly trained cybersecurity professional, I could give this to a six-year-old, and I could ask the same question. What's interesting here? What do you see? What's different from the rest? And I'm going to hear things like, oh, patterns of data. I see some dark, some light. I see some, you know, some people see an elephant with the trunk hanging down the far left. Who knows? And mathematicians will, you know, amid the more predictable patterns with this data, I see several interesting trends indicative of the negative slope within the data, which have ranges extending beyond. You know, you can get all these definitions, but bottom line is we all see things in here, and most of us will identify these as interesting cases, as we did. Okay, so we're looking at this, and we're going, okay, what's going on here? What's happening? What can we do with this data? So we'll just say that these five cases, let's look more closely at what this data represents. First, this is a huge data dump. There's a lot of data in here, okay? And what it is it represents ATM data, where time is going on as we move downward in the image. And on the left, we have account balance checks, and on the right, we have withdrawals. And you notice that the red things are happening in very close approximate time. And on the right, at the top, they have more time. And this is because of this inherent ATM etiquette that we have. We don't, you know, jump on top of someone as they're using it and jump on the second they're off. We've got this, you know, this unwritten etiquette that we wait far away. We don't look at their, you know, their transaction. And when they walk away, we walk up, and this introduces a natural time lag. So when there is a large number of cards with no, or activities with no time lag, all of a sudden we're like, maybe this is unusual activity. And in this case, it was. It was, let's move ahead. Okay, so case one was just a rapid sequence of balance checks. Case two was a balance checks at one machine, withdrawals at another. So see, I've added at the top that each column is a different ATM. And interestingly enough, when people are looking at this data, very few people report that there are columns. They observe it, but they don't report it. And on the far right, I have the time where this is going on. So let's go on case three. Balance checks followed by withdrawals. In case four, we've got a card in green here where they're doing balance checks on the far left and then giving the cards to people to go collect at a whole bunch of other things. And we learned other cool things from this data. Why are the, you know, why is case one and two at the top of the chart near midnight, and why is case three and four at the bottom near midnight? And you know, when we looked backwards at that data, we're like, oh, well, obviously, after midnight, the card resets and you can, you know, steal the same stuff from the same people. So this data was not collected for this reason. This data was, I believe, collected for ATM placement, because ATM placement is important because you make money, or banks make money based on, you know, if you use someone else's ATM, you get their, you know, you pay them. So that's just an interesting finding. Data collected for one reason, see an anomaly, use abductive reasoning to go back and figure out what caused that anomaly. Okay, so let's, here's some other graphs. I challenged my HoneyNet project buddies when I first started working on these sorts of problems to just send me data. Please send me data, and I'm gonna dump it into visualizations, find anomalies, and then send them back to you for you to try and figure out what exactly is going on. Okay, so I'm gonna, the first, let's just look at one of these, because they actually are all the same data. And this is a bipartite visualization where you have two parameters, and the strength or the weight of the line in between the two parameters shows the connection or the strength of the connection between them. Okay, so here's what they actually stand for. The green one, this is Twitter data provided by a HoneyNet project friend. And number one means a Twitter account was opened or created in using English language. And number two is a single day. So this is 5 years of data. but on October 12th, 2014, all of these accounts were written, were created at one time in English. So that provides Twitter with actionable intelligence that they can go back and couple with other information for the accounts created that day. So let's go back and think about our bank example. If someone came up to me and said, can you, you know, solve the problem of reducing or mitigating ATM card fraud, I would have went, huge problem. And I would have started looking at it. Okay. So same with Twitter. If Twitter came in and said, how do we detect Twitter bots? You know, huge problem. However, this data just said, boom, go look at these accounts. So I'm going to let's look at the same data, different representations. So on the left here, we have an exact same data. On the left here, we have 6 years. Each row on the left is a year, and then each block there is a month. And you can see that within that data, there are ideas, there are locations where there are clearly anomalies that we should probably investigate, okay? So on the right is the same thing, but you're seeing 5-minute intervals, hours going across the top, 5-minute intervals going down. Okay, so here's a question. Do you need like a fancy visualization and things like this to solve cybersecurity problems like this? Absolutely not. So I'm just gonna jump ahead to, okay. So what do we do if we wanna look for threats? And it doesn't have to be threats either, it can be, you know, look for anything that we didn't know we were looking for. So like I'm testing cloud network firewalls, right? And I'm looking at these and I'm working with vendors. And one thing obviously they're concerned about in the cloud is CPU utilization. And I sit with them and they're consistently watching, you know, they might be in little boxes, but these percentage numbers showing what each CPU is doing. And it's not something humans are good at. It's easy to look away, to blink, to miss a spike value, something like that. So as I've watched people do this, you know, they're trying to track through CPU utilization for 32 CPUs fluctuating over time, identifying, you know, anomalies. We're just not good at that. It's just not the way we process things well. So I grab the same data and I pop it into a spreadsheet and use just the basic, you know, graph capabilities. And all of a sudden, we've got, you know, we have a line representing each CPU and we can identify anomalies and we can scroll back and forward over time and we can apply abductive reasoning to work with, you know, vendors to try and identify the root cause for these anomalies within CPU utilization. And we tend to see it looks a lot like, you know, models a classroom, right? With a group project where, you know, there's that one slacker who's just sitting there, you know, trying not to be seen. And then there's a couple of bands maybe that are Pelotons that are consistently working, you know, above or below average. And then there's, you know, that one person, that would be me, who's just like up at the top, just working as hard as they can because they want their team to succeed. You know, those kind of things are evident visually when we, you know, even just drop something into a simple visualization tool like a spreadsheet. So I have, you know, I have produced highly specialized analysis tools for clients that let them, you know, basically dump data in one end and it generates massive numbers of images using a bunch of visualization techniques. And then they can, you know, select or reject things and choose what to analyze in that way. Because all of you, any of you who have pored over log files know that you miss things and you can't see everything at once. And there are so many log files. So just being able to take the cybersecurity data and just dump it into things we can visualize, whether they are, you know, complex tools or simple things like spreadsheets, makes our life so much easier because we're doing things that we excel at in that case, which is looking for anomalies and differences within data and then using that to try and determine exactly the reasoning behind what's going on. So that is what I wanted to share, because I've many times see, you know, analysts poring over log files, long data, or all the efforts that are going in to getting computers, which I'm totally on board with, but trying to get computers to do things that we just inherently do well. And that's awesome. We should advance technology and we should get computers to be able to do these things. But right now we do it better. And so we should, you know, be doing the things that we do well. So let computers do what computers are good at, and let the people do what people are good at. And we're really good at pattern recognition and dealing with missing information and uncertainty. And then we can, you know, help both by providing them the resources they need to facilitate what they're good at. So that is what I wanted to zoom through really quickly and hopefully empower you all to know that your brains are awesome. So I would like to open, I think we have time for a few questions. So if anyone has questions, please add them to the chat and I will address questions until the top of the hour. So if I'm saying threats should be referred to as anomalies until verified as malicious. Totally agree. And it also separates you from people who identify the anomalies and the people who are analyzed through root cause do not have to be the same people. Okay. As I said, six-year-old, you give the image of the ATM fraud to a six-year-old, they will identify anomalies. Okay. They're not trained in cybersecurity. They generally don't work in banking, but they'll see the differences. You know, they won't give you the hard level mathematician negative slope line, but they'll say those lines are slanty and those ones aren't. Okay, so lots of questions. This is a good one. How do you inspire children to open their minds to seeing things in a unique way to approach problems? So I think one of the coolest things is to not give them instructions. You know, let them explore and discover things before you start telling them, you know, and here's how step by step you do things. Because when you teach someone something step by step, you are you know, pigeonholing. And I see a lot of mathematics, especially. You are pigeonholing people into a particular algorithm. And a lot of people and kids don't like math or think they don't like math because the algorithms they were told to solve these problems don't match with the way their brains work. Okay, so I'm a big fan of not providing instructions, but waiting until someone is unable to discover where to go next. And at that point, providing instruction or guidance. What are some of the commercial applications of lessons from my research, or is it just AI and doing things we always did but differently? Oh, that's a hard question. I am by no means an expert in everything that's going on out there because there's so much going on. But I have the open source community is actually where I see a lot of real creativity, because for whatever reason, the people that come up with really unique things in many cases want to share that with as many people as possible. Okay. Let's see. Have I looked at machine learning or neural networks for pattern recognition, since you potentially have a lot of data for... Absolutely. My PhD was in AI back before AI was a real thing. So yes, I've looked at it and I monitor it and follow along, but the efforts to get, say commercial products to actively do things is not to actively recognize classes of things. We see these examples like, oh, this does letter recognition and this does, you know, it can tell a plant from another plant. But a six-year-old can do that, and a six-year-old can also do a million other contexts of the same or similar product projects without training. So I'm my vote's for the six-year-olds at this point, but I'd like the world to keep evolving in AI and machine learning also. What are some ways to find these things that normally overlook since we're looking at things a particular way? So something really cool that I have found shows you things. If you dump stuff in a spreadsheet and then like totally zoom out really far to where you're just seeing shades of, you know, basically grayscale, you'd be amazed how many anomalies people can find just by doing that simple thing. Patterns and anomalies. And so there are all kinds of little steps. And then I have another question. Any suggestions on visualization tools? So I'm for open source, cheap, easy. Don't, you know, crack peanuts with sledgehammers. So Excel and, you know, Google Sheets, all those have phenomenal tools for visualizing things. But I can tell you that the tool that I made that generated all kinds, and this was a few years ago, generated all kinds of visualizations was, you know, basically the D3 JavaScript libraries were the starting point. I went in there and went, hey, people are doing really cool visualizations. Let's just, you know, kind of make a collection of capabilities, a collection of data, and then just boom, you know, see what they come up with. Okay, so I think we're at the end of our time. We're really close, so I'm gonna have to wrap this up. But thank you for coming. Thank you for your questions and your showing me your brains at work. That was awesome. And I'll turn it back to Casey.
Thank you so much, Kara. That was great. Appreciate you being here to join us. And thank you, everyone, for tuning in. To find products or solutions related to artificial intelligence and machine learning, we invite you to visit rsaconference.com/marketplace. Here you'll find an entire ecosystem of cybersecurity vendors and service providers who can assist you with your specific needs. Thank you so much for joining us. Have a great day.